Hello everyone and welcome back to WePlay Season 3, our last game for the European night. But don't worry, if you're looking for more Dota 2, there is coming up one series later on tonight, the Peruvian matchup. So keep your eyes peeled out for that one. For now, let's go to our game. Ryu, we had ourselves a break. Grab yourself maybe some dinner or some tea.
I got some dinner in me.
You got some dinner.
I had a steak, a big fat juicy steak with some potatoes and some green beans. No, not peas and carrots. No green beans.
You know, in some countries when they hear green beans, they'll probably actually still think you're talking about, like, peas.
Really? That'd be funny. So, I don't know. I mean, you just mix peas and carrots together and it just tastes good. I wonder how it would... I don't think carrots and green beans go to... Yeah, I don't even want to try that, actually.
It would be fine. It's just a little bit more greeny.
I don't think it has the same texture. It can mix well. I don't know. It's like the peas. They kind of, like, mesh well with the carrots.
You've made me want to watch Forrest Gump all over again.
Forrest Gump.
Me and Jenny, we're all like peas and carrots again. Is that what you're looking for? Is my American accent up to standard?
I mean, anyone can sound like an American. All you gotta do is be stupid, right?
No. Okay, let's get to our game. Wow.
I mean, I'm American. I can definitely say that, at least.
Yeah, I'm Australian. I'm a convict. I can say whatever the hell I want.
Convict. Yeah, we threw your prisoner ass over from...
You didn't throw crap. You're not the English.
Boats.
You're not the English.
Yeah, I'm the English.
And the English actually sent the best and the brightest down to Australia. And what were they left with?
The best and the brightest.
Nothing but frickin' upper class. All right. Let's get into our game. Let's stop talking
best
about this other jazz.
Best and the brightest and Toby.
So we have PRIES going up against Wombat Gaming. Wombat Gaming have not had a terrific time in WePlay. In fact, they are 1-10 at their 11 games. PRIES have had a little bit more luck. They're at 4-6. They still have basically an impossible run. The chance of either of these teams actually qualifying for the LAN finals is pretty much beyond them. So we look at this game as good scrim practice, as well as maybe something inventive for us to look at. That's pretty much it.
Can I bet right now? Because it looks like PRIES, if that's how you say their name, is going to win.
PRIES.
I always said like Prius or something like.
Yeah, yeah. Initially when I first cast these guys, I was saying Prius, because I'm just like, oh, that should be how it's pronounced, right? And I just thought of the car, and that was the joke of the night.
10 seconds remaining.
And then I actually took the time, I looked it up, and it's actually Prius.
Prius. I Prius you, Toby.
Close.
For looking it up.
It's close to that, but it's pronounced slightly different.
Prius.
Praise. That's it. Instead of praise.
Yeah, right. I get you. Yeah. I got you.
Beautiful. All right. So we're into our draft. Kind of surprising considering Mastermind's been playing almost nothing but Invoker and OD. They're the first two heroes that Pawn actually bans out. At the same time, though, Wombat Gaming have also been playing a lot of OD. Maybe not the Invoker as much, but definitely the OD. But they start with a Gyro as well as a Chen. Can't really go wrong with that. Good push power. Good teamfight supremacy. It's not a bad first two. But they give up the Earth Spirit because of their bans.
Yeah, I'm one of those people who like the trade where if you give me Chen and you give the enemy team Earth Spirit, I'll do that 9 times out of 10. Just because Earth Spirit... He wants to be able to cause a lot of havoc in the mid lane. So what you do is you can get a jungler. You can offset it by getting some good creeps early on. And you can just, you know, go mid, shut him down. Or you can just farm up, get a mechanism, get a lot in, a lot more presence on the map. And not knowing where he is, I just think the Chen will contribute way more in the mid game team fights than the Earth Spirit will. Saying that... I've seen some sick-ass Earth Spirit silences into kicks where you completely shut down Chen and then, like, he's just absolute food. So it's just a trade-off of, like, okay, Earth Spirit's going to come in the mid lane, going to cause a lot of ruckus, and now you have a puck that's going to come on top of that. What are Priest going to really do to handle all this aggression here early? Queen of Pain's not too bad.
Quad wouldn't be too bad. My mind goes to Viper. I want to get that in before they pick it. 5 seconds remaining. Primarily because I'm just looking at this lineup, and you're right. Like, the Earth Spirit could cause a lot of problems. They need a tanky hero that's able to do something when this team of Praise is ready to push. And that kind of doing things is having mech, allowing Chen to go in for an early Ags or something else, and they just force down buildings. You got a Nature's Prophet, so if Earth Spirit does overcommit onto the Viper, which is easy to do when he's so tanky, or immune, or resistant, I should say. The Nature's Prophet just TPs in, sprouts.
He's banned, though, sadly.
He is. So.
It's okay, Toby. I've done that before.
I didn't check.
Toby's. It's fine.
Hang on. Whoa. Night Stalker?
Yeah, support Night Stalker. Or it could be Jungling Furion with the chin, Kappa. No, it's.
safe lane Prophet and mid lane Gyro, or mid lane Prophet up against the puck.
That's not that good, because Nature's Prophet can work in mid lane because of how much damage he can do with his treants, and because he's in the Dire. This time you can just send your creeps uphill and they won't immediately die to the towers, and that could easily harass the puck here in the mid lane. But you still have the Earth Spirit. One good roll in, you're pretty much dead here from the Nature's Prophet. That's why I was thinking Wombat might have block pick with the puck here. They were like, okay, well, we really want something that's going to be that can escape in the mid lane, and that's what puck gives you. And then puck has this silence now that it kind of blocks out the Queen of Pain, where we're going to have puck silence and Earth Spirit silence, and it could screw over her day.
I just want to say that's my one ticket for fuck up tonight. We can leave it at the door, the Viper thing. We'll get over it. But Death Prophet, she was left in the pool.
Yeah, that's
until
weird.
The very end. And you pick a support Night Stalker over a Death Prophet.
Her win rate's like, what, 35, 40? It's really low now.
It's pretty low, but when you're going on these type of push strats, it would work really nicely. Soul Assumption's really great up against Earth Spirit if he's running at you, even up against the Beastmaster. He roars on you if you've already got one of those, like, those soul siphons going. You're pretty damn good. Silence, there's a lot of things which are being added which she would have been perfect for. And I'm still wondering now, who do you run in the mid? If the Viper's taken out, most of the mids are removed. The Ember Spirit's the final ban out from press, so they're just worried about the counter push. You know actually what I'd love to see? It would be so stupid, but it would be so... stupid. I couldn't actually think of a good way of actually saying this, because I don't think there is
TA?
One. TA was actually in my mind a little bit, but I was actually thinking more about something like a Pugna. If they go for all out for push, but I don't think Pugna gets played a lot. No, actually, I know Pugna doesn't get played a hell of a lot.
She would... The problem is Pugna would go like 0-3 in the lane, but when it comes to the team fights, it would be tremendously hard for them to really fight into the Nether Ward.
Yep.
But that's at the same time, like, she's going to feed Puck an early Blink Dagger, though, because you're not going to be able to stay in the lane at all because of that Earth Spirit.
But I think about what happens when you hit, like, that four-minute mark. Like, you want to start forcing down buildings. Like, you got a Prophet and a Chen. You want to open up the space for the Night Stalker. You don't have, like, a huge farmer for Wombat right now. And if they go something like a Spectre, it's going to come on too late. So they need something earlier. Zven, also another big carry that normally gets picked up, but he'd also probably come on too late up against this this Priest lineup. Priest.
Yeah, that name's hard. I just want to say Prius all the time when I see it. And
yeah,
I'm just like,
yeah, you've got it in my head now. Priest.
Yeah. Praise, yeah.
I even took the time to learn this stuff.
It took the time, but you can't unlearn what I taught you recently.
It's that tick we were talking about before. Okay, so a Slark pickup definitely comes on. Okay, Slark definitely comes online a lot earlier than the other options we were talking about before, and is also a hero which Wombat Gaming has played frequently. I say frequently. If you actually look back through the matches of Wombat Gaming, their last game was 2 days ago, but the game before that was back on the 9th. They actually had themselves a decent break in their games. And that last game they played back on the 9th was up against Team Liquid, where they got slaughtered. Like, it was pretty hard. It would force you into a one-week break.
I felt those crushing defeats every time I went against EG back in the day, or, you know, even Liquid back then, when they were still American. But it's just one of those tough decisions, like tough things to be a tier 3 team when you're going up against a tier 1 team. And that's what you're trying to do. You're trying to make the progression into being able to stand on your own against these higher up teams. And then sometimes you just fall short, and then you're like, do we need to change people? Do we need more practice? Because that's what Dota is all about, right? Once you start losing, and then once you start losing a lot, you just think about so many different things, like people. Is it me? Is it them? Is it we're not good enough yet?
It's not you. It's just the game.
It's Toby's fault.
Thanks a lot.
Everything that goes wrong in my life, it's Toby.
I think, wow. It's a lot of responsibility to throw on my shoulders, man. I'm not going to take that. Missing middle. I like how, like, this is a small mental thing, but why did the Dire side start facing to the east? They're facing away from victory every day. I never realized that before. That's the first time I've seen it where all five of them are just standing in the opposite direction.
Well, the sun rises in the east, so they're just looking at a bright future for them.
Technically, that means actually the Radiant side can get out to lane faster because the Dire side have to turn. Just saying, imbalance.
Imbalance.
It's... small things.
It doesn't matter when Night Stalker's still walking around with a blank.
They just saw that. Like, they already had their own observer ward down, so they're gonna instantly deward that Dire observer. 30 seconds to battle. They're such a successful thing as well. Oh, hello, Beastmaster and Night Stalker just playing around.
I was watching them playing footsies. Oh yeah, 36 gold,
29 experience. He's about to give more of it over. But this is actually when you want to see the Sentry Ward get dropped down and give Puck, like, level 2 straight off the bat. Is that attack going to be there in time? No, that's not enough.
I mean, we still haven't even talked about, like, this tiny mid versus Puck. Tiny.
Yeah,
just...
the pick came, and I kind of wanted to ignore it.
Yeah, same. I was like, okay, well, this is weird as hell, and Puck should just dominate this heavily.
Yeah, after first thinking about it, like, I'm like, okay, well, this is just odd, because your push power doesn't really come. Like, if you rush an Aghanim Scepter, you don't really have the attack speed to work with. Like, you're just using the upgraded toss damage to, like, that would be it. So, what's your play with a Tani? Then I'm like, okay, well, he's got to be a ganker, right? But you're already getting that kind of out from the Night Stalker. And the ganker from a Tani would be the quick blink dagger kind of play. But you can't guarantee you're going to get the farm in the lane up against the Puck, and you can't take the Puck out of the lane. Puck's phase shift will always dodge, even if Avalanche does have 2 instances of damage and stun.
Yeah. If he does get on top of the Puck, he can do the combo pretty effectively. And having only 1 in phase shift, he'll still be able to set up because of the Avalanche will still be there at the end of the phase shift. Then he should be able to still get toss off. But it's just a weaker Dragon Knight. And you said Praise really want to push the tempo. Maybe a Dragon Knight would have been better. Like, Dragon Knight sure doesn't win against the Puck, but he doesn't necessarily lose. Like, he won't die. He can just bottle crow. But Tiny here, it's different. You're not putting a flame breath on him to reduce his attack damage. You're not bottle growing.
Yeah,
I mean, this is just gonna be,
and you can't capitalize on the time when the Chen and the Prophet could group up on top, because that was always the other power of the DK. Like, you'd hit level 6, you trigger your dragon form, and then you instantly do damage to the tier 1 tower. Now Mastermind's gonna get ganked up. WG, he's already on a half life now. This Avalanche does a little bit, but this is a Tiny who's trying to bottle rush. You can start munching on your tangos, but they're shared tangos. Obviously, there's no happy tree support in this one. So, Edie's going to have himself a great time. Like, there's little that's really going to harass him. Every time he hits one of these orbs as well, it's just a little bit further that Rain can push the tempo and try and come after that. But that was a pretty, like, optimistic boulder roll.
Yeah, he kind of timed it wrong. When Mastermind went for the deny first, he could have went for the play again, but thinking that he'd go up for the CS, he rolled in. And if you look at EDE, he went for a really aggressive build here. He doesn't even have anything in the phase shift. He just wants to kill him.
Hedrox?
Now
again. Rain's just a second too late. Like, if that leash latched from the Slark, then they would have had a chance for then Witch Doctor to follow up with his stun. But they didn't have the range on both of the abilities. So Nature's Prophet avoids the gank. Which is pretty good for Jedrox, considering he had no vision of the movement. They lost their Observer Ward in mid. And I actually... Where is their second? It's still on the Chen.
Bottom lane. Stun bounce. Correct. That's unfortunate.
It is. Push the issue just a little bit too far.
I mean, he even had his Treants there for the extra.
Oh, the regen. Stun, the regen, toss. The regen.
Oh, yeah.
Who's right. Got it? Tiny actually grabs it. It's inside of his bottle. That's... Mastermind needed a break, and that's kind of it. Because this will actually force Puck back. He doesn't have a bottle of his own yet. Tiny is actually... he's not ahead of him in CS. You shall
not. Oh, I get a phase shift that.
How did Mastermind actually get his bottle first?
Because he was able to get...
They both got the bounty rune. It's the null talisman. I forgot about the null talisman on the puck. It set him back a little bit further.
Yeah, he kind of went for that bottle rush build, but that's a huge win for him in this situation. You really want to fill up your bottle all the time, and then you don't have the bottle crow. Oh, that's huge win. And then we even have this Nightstalker coming over. This could be a kill. They should go on him. They
saw him. Here comes the ball to roll in, and they go over onto the Nightstalker. He gets kicked back a little bit. That actually doesn't help out the puck to keep up with them. But you've got another roll in 6 seconds' time. And with that orb fall, it's going to force the Nightstalker just to try and run around a little bit further. The Chen's going to rotate in. And now with the silence over on that Earth Spirit, can he roll away in time? No, he can't. The Chen will find the kill. And Nightstalker, not sure if intentional bait, but he's definitely buying out so he can die to a neutral.
Yeah, he was baiting there. He wanted the puck to come in. If puck had went in, the Chen would have got the kill. And that was not the play there. He didn't drop a stone, it looked like. I think he just misplaced or something.
Ooh, nice note. Leash. Very, very, very easy. The second that leash latches, you can actually start with the malediction and follow up with the paralyzing cast control. And then a simple TP in from the Earth Spirit. But now we hit nighttime. It's only a level 2 Nightstalker whose portrait is still dead.
I know, I tried to tell you about that earlier, but...
Yeah, no, we talked about it during the last game, Puck. It's like,
how is it still there? I thought it might have been a bug from him dying, you know, but nope.
Nightstalker, a little bit more damage, that's it. Malediction will pop him on the last one. So the Witch Doctor will find the kill. This now brings you to 3-1.
You want to do your blackness joke, Toby? He's,
God! No! No!
Into the darkness.
No! Just no.
Oh, this is a cute play from Chen. He killed off his, when he got his new creep. Oh, he gets so many boulders, yeah.
3 studs. Unfortunately, the creep wave just arrived. The flat cannon damage.
Yeah, you got
it. That's the last one? Yep.
Oh, he didn't salve! He could have salved. Yeah, this game is...
Wait, didn't he salve? I heard the sound effect go. I think he did it too late.
Oh, he did. Yeah, he did it too late.
So yeah, he.
But that was a really smart play from Chen. He immediately sacrificed one of his golems, splitting them in two, and then he got to control 3 different creeps there. Or, like, I guess 4.
Alright, but it was the 3 stuns that you were really looking for. Nightstalker moving up to the top. They can see the fact that the Earth Spirit's just sitting there. They can also see that the Earth Spirit doesn't have enough mana for a roll. Chill's gonna make his move up. So with the boars, looks like Tani actually killed the puck in the meantime. We weren't watching that one. Instead, I wanted to keep my eyes on this fight on top of while the boar is blocking the Prey's lineup. They couldn't just run in. Puck dying to the Tiny? Like, there's not even a blink dagger up, but this Tiny now has a 3-3 combo. Actually skilling up his ultimate form too, so he skilled up Grow. Before actually maxing out his, like the 4-4 combo, like the Q and the W.
Yeah, I'm really surprised he didn't go for the max and toss. You get way more damage when you have your toss maxed and you grow, because you get the toss bonus damage. It's way more beneficial getting the grow nowadays than going just, well,
Puck.
You got the dead puck
that
again.
Silence. That was actually so smart. He saw the puck orbed away and silenced him up at the time when he would have jaunted. So you got all your damage out, and now they can inflict a lot of damage into that mid-tier 1 tower. The toss to help with the damage, there's no fortification until now being triggered. But this is a little bit too late, with the double Hadouken creeps, like you already got the regeneration in the lane, not to mention if anyone comes forward, actually, sorry, it's not even a double, it's a triple. He's got three set of Tormentors. Like, this Chen can actually solo up almost everyone apart from the Slark. Radiant's top
tower is under attack. That's like 480 damage. I think math is off. Yeah, five.
It's 480 from the Satyrs. Yep. But then
you have Test of Faith or no? Yeah.
Yeah, which will do a maximum 200.
Mm-hmm. Radiant's top tower is under attack. Everybody's dead. And then they have a lot of, you know, controlling things. Tiny, we have the Sprouts coming in now. And do we have any? We have only really one Quelling Blade. Obviously, Beastmaster can get out of those with the Wild Axes, but not if you're silenced already. So they don't have that many things to really escape. And the Puck just keeps feeding and feeding. He's not even going to have a closely... Oh, top. There we go. Call down. Rip Chill.
Oh, going on to the Beastmaster. That's a lot of TPs on the way. Meanwhile, in the middle lane, I was waiting for that gank to happen. It was the attack onto the Puck, so he goes down again, and Gyrocopter showing just how powerful he is. Let's look at the Treants in there, and the Paralyzing Cast get bounced over to the Prophet while he was trying to TP out. So the Gyrocopter goes in again, the Rocket Barrage, Slark got that Shadow Dance available, and he's battling around his own Creep Wave. The Sprout from Genox actually gives space to Pawn. The Paralyzing Cast will bounce down. He needs the Creep Wave to actually take it, but it bounced back up to the Gyrocopter, which allowed the Dark Pack to have that last bit of damage until the Nightstalker gets tossed on top of the Slark. They're chasing after the Beastmaster Priest.
Oh, here comes the Blink Dagger, baby. Oh yeah, it's happening.
Well, once that's there, then this Beastmaster, they need someone else in range. The Avalanche will connect, the Toss will follow up. He's still bottle charging, and he's just gonna punch him. Like, stick charges or not. Like, in 2 seconds time, this Beastmaster, okay, maybe that's one way to do it. Denied to the side, they actually go in. The Chill hasn't denied himself yet. He actually, now he gets denied up by the neutral creep. Avalanche is a bubble and said he'll go for the Toss here, Mastermind. Waiting for that Crackly to trigger and get one last punch into the Earth Spirit, but he is not rewarded. So WG, they at least get to stop this Tiny, and the Puck finally gets some money, but they've just lost their Tier 1 tower while they did that, as well as their Tier 1, like, on top and bottom.
Yeah, Tiny actually dies when he was in probably the hardest lane to be in this game, and that's pretty impressive for him just already have a Blink Dagger at 9 minutes. He's fulfilling Puck's roles, but even better. He's going to go around and just one-shot everybody now, and nobody can survive except for the Slark. And the Slark is going into this Drums build, so he's not going to have a great initiation. He's not going to have a Blink Dagger. He's not going to have a Shadow Blade. And
he's really delaying it, too, because he went for Ring of Aquila on top of that Drums. At least he's got the most amount of net worth on the field, so that's an upside.
It's really hard for them to get back into this game for Wombat. You really have to have the Puck with the Blink Dagger to really set up the kills. If you're them in this situation, you need Beastmaster to hit level 6 ASAP, which they will give them the space hopefully here in the jungle. I would rather him be in the mid lane though than this Puck, because they need to start smoking up and making plays.
At the same time, maybe they just counterplay it. They put down two defensive observer wards, and they got an opportunity here in middle lane. The Dream Call is going to go to work, man. That Wrath of Nature on call down. That did a lot of damage. So So Jedrox will come in for a trade-off, but he's all here alone. With the paralyzing cast bouncing around, he's actually going to give himself a double kill. He can't TP out of here. Like, he'll summon up a bunch of treants, and maybe he can find Edie. But that's a two-for-two trade-off when, like, Preyz had a huge advantage. So they're going to be giving a lot more over to WG. Yeah, you see the swing for that one. It's about 1,500 going the way there of WG for a 2-2 trade.
Yeah, he thought he could do way more burst damage than he actually had, and they didn't even use Hand of God there, which is kind of confusing for me. If Gyrocopter could have got off like one or two more attacks, maybe even the Rocket Barrage, they could have potentially killed them all. But still, where's the Tiny? Mastermind has been the tempo controller this game. He's even going for an Arcane Boot build here. It's daytime though, not scary anymore.
They'll just wait it out until the next chance to attack. They also need to do something about this vision of WG. Like, the movement that Praise was able to have across this map was pretty uncontested until WG put down those two Observer Wards. Now, it's very obvious from afar, like, where Praise are coming from. It looks like they're expecting it to still be, like River Wards, not to be that defensive. Judging by their own sentry placement.
Mid lane, do they have hunting? Oh, they have vision of Y50, but...
Yeah. There's a radiant observer ward down. Like, Y50 could be there. Okay, you're gonna avoid a puck illusion. The Wrath of Nature also bounces through. So a little of extra damage, but where are they going to go? At least at this point, the Radiant Observer Ward isn't watching Praise until they run around the corner, which then is when the Night Stalker gets stunned up. They commit a lot, but now look for the three set of blasts to come. One, two. It actually hits so hard, and then the extra TPM from Prophet will find that kill. Y50's still alive, and he's got Death Ward available as the Magnetize gets triggered. Now, the toss, you can get triggered even harder on that one. Sprout into the Beastmaster. He doesn't actually have a way to get out of that. So the end cooldown will get the kill. In fact, it's going to be Jedrox's last attack. A 4-for-1 trade-off. Mastermind's almost dying to that Magnetize, but he ends up surviving. And Praise take a 1-to-4 fight.
Yeah, if they had gotten the kickoff from... and it had hit the Tiny, he would have died there because Slark was attacking him. But still, at the end of the day, it would have been a 4-for-2? But they're not going to win these team fights, especially when they have Hand of God. They don't have the proper initiation. You blow all your spells on top. Oh, mid.
Did she find an opening? It's over on the Tani. Avalanche buys a little bit of space, and Nightstalker is also causing problems, but you've got Jedrox already on the field. Always there to help out. The jump down. Oh, the toss damage. It's enough. It's just enough to kill the Slark as he came out of the Dark Pact.
I was thinking he might get denied or something wonky.
Middle lane now. Chill's in trouble. Silence. They got called on a verbal if Gyro wants to use it, which he's going to. Now, in return, the Death Ward gets to go out from the Witch Doctor. There's not enough damage there from Pawn to get the kill on Y50 because the Voodoo Restoration just did too much work. So now it will actually be two big kills going the way of WG. And again, another big swing. 1,600. In fact, the swing itself is about 2.1k in the gold.
Man, this Gyrocopter has been a little bit underwhelming in these situations. He's trying to do too much on his own and look like a hero. And just these Witch Doctor bounces, you cannot underestimate a Witch Doctor in teamfights just because he has... It feels like he only has one stun, right? But in actuality, most of the times, he's been getting off these amazing, crazy, bouncing back to Furion, easy kills on Gendrix. And then also in these teamfights, the Gyrocopter just keeps on getting hindered his movement speed. But still, they're very far ahead.
Check this out on top. Tani picked up an Aether Lens. I believe the only ability, you correct me if I'm wrong on this, it's only the toss, right? Like, the toss range is being increased?
As well as the Avalanche. And then the Blink, too. It's both the spells. It'll help out a lot in initiating. But I'm trying to figure out how the interaction works with toss. Like...
Like, if you should be able to target a unit which is further away, so you can...
Yes,
but
that's
what
I'm trying to think.
It's like, is it the unit which is sitting next to you, or the unit which you're throwing towards? Like, it should be the unit you're throwing towards. Actually, it should be both.
I'm trying to think of it. You know, if it's like the flaming lasso, right? It increases the cast point of that. So is it the same for the tiny toss? If anybody out there knows in chat, I would love to know that, since we don't get that many tiny games, especially going for Etherlands too. That's just crazy. He's just going full utility right now. That'd be nice to know if it increases like the point blank toss range. So say, yeah, there's like a creep, like he's right here, tiny, and then say the creep's right, got it, right here or something. Can he toss it? I try to draw on the map. It's so hard.
It really is easy.
I was pressing the wrong button. I think I was pressing Windows.
Well done.
Stupid Windows Kingdom.
You see also the build coming out from Jedrox. It's like we've gone back about a year in Dota. Double null talismans into Blade Mel. Then you followed up with the Maelstrom. That's pretty damn unique.
Yeah, that's that old school, baby.
It is.
I wanted to talk about it a little bit when I saw it picked up, but I was like, who can he actually blow up? Because obviously it helps out a lot for the Slark, but he'll just go into Shadow Dance and immediately heal back up. It could be really good for the Puck, but other than that, I'm trying to figure out where it's going to come from. Because it just looks like he's just going to die in team fights. He still doesn't have enough HP, only 1100.
But then again, Nature's Prophets normally function on that much HP at this point of the game, because they would go for like a Hand of Midas build instead. Like, this is a lot more, I want to be in the middle of team fights. Let's say bottom lane. Puck's actually down. They go for the roar on the Nightstalker. So Nightstalker's about to join the Puck in the afterlife. He can't get one last void off. Mastermind gets enough space, so now he's able to bottle up. They actually didn't use the Hand of God that time around. They held on to it once again, so Nightstalker obviously wasn't worth it in their mind. Or he was just dead to rights.
Let's just say that Puck is not the Puck that we saw earlier from what's his name again? What's his name now on Power Rangers?
The Puck on Power Rangers?
Kadra. I think it's Kadra. Something like that. It's okay, guys. I stumped Toby. That was what I wanted to do.
Son
we won.
Bitch. Son of a bitch.
We did it. We did it, family.
Kino. Kino.
Okay.
Yeah. You bastard. Well, hello, Black Dragon.
Oh, hello, Gyrocopter.
It's coming down. Yep, they jump up. They jump on the Gyrocopter. Nice silence and a big combo. But that's a successful smoke gank. Not only just to kill off the Gyrocopter, but also to take out these ancients of theirs. I'm still wondering, though, like if fights like this is going to be enough, because you're being forced so hard on the side lanes. Hello? Ryu? Ah, damn it. Ryu? What? Yeah, I think it's you, bro. I can hear you from far away.
Hello, okay.
There you go.
No, I'm good. All right, I'm good.
What did you do to yourself?
That was the weirdest thing ever. I wasn't even moving. I'm like a stone statue here. I'm tiny. I didn't do anything.
I know. Tiny's doing a lot, bro. He's 5-1. He's 5-1-2 in this game.
Yeah, I didn't think of that when I said that.
Instantly proven wrong.
Dang it.
Whose turn is it to get caught out? I think it's Ryu's turn.
I used the right, but not in the right context. I used the right hero.
I used it right, but I was so wrong.
Yeah. Oh, I'm on Toby level today.
Yeah. Let's go back to those two stones and one stone.
I mean, this stone has done more
really
than...
Really, Prophet? You want to do this?
What is he doing?
He's completing a full Mjolnir. But he bought the recipe before he finished, like actually got the Hyperstone. This is very odd, to say
Please
the least.
Please don't take my granite gold. Because
this is so weird to say. Okay, I play a fair amount of Prophet, and I've studied a lot of Prophets for early builds. Now, in this game, like, you could have gone for something along the lines of Orchid, which would have been fantastic control across the map. Instead, he went for this, I want to be able to stand during the fight, so the Nults into the Blade Mel, that's the purpose of this, and then into a Maelstrom. Now, the Maelstrom gets you to push. And when you go a build like this, normally you're wanting to do damage to the high ground very early on. but this isn't the way to do it. Like, your attack speed is not going to be the greatest thing you're really looking for. Avalanche, well off target. That should have done something and lasted a little bit longer. And yep, hello. Say hello to him again. They're going to toss the gyrocopter forward into the rocket barrage in perfect sprout position. And you can say goodbye to the Witch Doctor as well. So maybe the item build didn't even matter. But I was going to say, like, you get something more cost efficient, like a Desolator, for example. It'll be so much better for pushing down the lanes and being ready to push down buildings. So these kind of pushes will be even quicker.
Yeah, can we also talk about how they let him kill off the Granite Golem and he has eggs on Chin and he just wants the Black Dragon?
Oh, that jump forward. Rain is going to go down. The cooldown's in a perfect position. With these kind of kills and a double damage rune over on the gyrocopter, they just keep buying back. You've got double catapults from Praise here. And Edie, well, there's no stone to him. Mastermind's waiting for his perfect opportunity. And now he's got his combo. So there it is. The Earth Spirit just evaporates. These buybacks, they've expended pretty much all of them. The Death Ward from Y50 allows him to at least force Praise back out of this fight. Now there's no mech, there's no Hand of God. And Nature's Prophet, okay, he'll TP out. The Chen will sacrifice himself. But the mid ranks are still down. The Black Dragons and the Double Catapults, they did their work, and they're going to actually finish up the range ranks as well. So that was three buybacks from WG. And they still lost their entire mid ranks.
Yeah, that's...
What? What? And now, Prophet? What?
Go Prophet!
He's actually using the Sprout as a distance thing. He almost killed off Edie with the damage output he had, but he bought a Blink Dagger.
If he just had popped his blade mail, like, 1 or 2 seconds later, he would have got a triple kill. That was... Well, there could have been something, now you're nothing.
They're calling for a gank on bottom. An Avalanche Tosh won't be enough, and you've still got Shadow Dance. That's the reason why they're waiting a little bit longer. But now Mastermind comes in. Avalanche, toss, call down. It connects. But
Mastermind could have force deft, but...
That could have worked.
There could be support coming in over the top, but I was thinking he could force deft in front of them and then get leaped on and then still follow up with another toss since it has a low cooldown.
It makes a lot of sense to do what was just pinged out by Price. You have a gyrocopter that wants to be building a damage item in a moment and you want to get a little bit more insurance on him. You're also running a Chen, and you're running a Nature's Prophet. Like, you've got Treants. Roshan should be dead. And that's where they're picking for. Jedrox? Yeah, I didn't think that TP was intentional. Going up onto the hillside there actually doesn't achieve anything for you. Unless you've got a gem on your side and you're trying to, like, D-ward. But that's not the case. And now you've also got a Vladimir's Offering on your Chen. These guys really don't want a mech.
You know, there's just so many weird things. We could even talk about the fact how Roche, it's 23 minutes, and that's the first attempt there was. Considering how far ahead the Dire side was, I mean...
It just seemed a little odd.
Yeah, there's just so many wonky things going on in this game. I just can't comprehend them, Toby. It's just me.
You're meant to comprehend it. You're the co-caster.
Like I said, I literally watched KYH pick up a Black Dragon instead of a Granite Golem. He left it for the enemy to kill, and then he let his Nature's Prophet kill another Granite Golem off. I'm still on tilt from watching that. Like, Granite Golem has to be the best, or second best.
It is. Like, it's so much life to your entire lineup. And, they may not need all the extra bonuses as they're just letting Pawn be this bait on the front line. And they're making disco with the Mjolnir effect.
Watch the
effect.
Frenzy Black Dragon. Well, Frenzy? Okay, you can Frenzy
Wrath of Mage is kicking in. They got some very deep vision here. But where's the follow-up? They go onto the gyrocopter. The Chen actually gets kicked in the middle of this. But your Avalanche toss. The Slark is down. The Puck's down as well. You go for your Wish Doctor Death Ward, but it's such minimal damage. Hand of God repaired most of it, and the Slark went back into the fight. Chen got forced out by the Tiny. It gave him the space to try and outrun the Slark. With the Void, the Urns, it's already a triple kill for the Prophet. And well, yep, Chen gonna penitence him. Where's your Avalanche? Where's your Toss? You're gonna throw both of them out. The Chen survives on sub 90 life. You've taken out the bottom racks, and good game, well played. In 25-25, Price will take the victory up against Wombat Gaming. And the Germans continue to struggle. in WePlay with only one victory to their name.
Well, you wanted WePlay action, Toby? Well, you got it. This is what it's been like for most of the games that I've casted. You get to see 20-25 minute stomps and one-sided affairs. Great stuff. Great stuff. But in all seriousness, I don't even know what to think of the game. I mean, we talked about it at length. Puck and Earth Spirit should have at least killed the Tiny two times, if not three. Chen didn't even rotate in that much. There was just way too much room given and space. Obviously, once the Night Stalker first hit nighttime, he just went around and kept killing the Puck. Mm-hmm. Puck just kept feeding in the mid lane. That's the one hero you have to have a great start on. That's your tempo controller in this game. So him getting shut down basically screws over your early game, mid game, and you don't even get to late game.
It wasn't the greatest display of Dota we've ever seen, and there's definitely a lot the teams can take from it so they can work on it. We definitely had some clowns in it, especially when Gyrocopter finishes with two S and Ys.
Especially when Toby forgets what bands are.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, I hope you enjoy your casting over the next few days. No, you're not allowed to cast anymore. You've been replaced. Because Cap's coming back tomorrow. He's actually doing the WePlay games tomorrow, and he's casting, I think, all of them, not with Ryu, with Mott Pack.
I actually asked him.
He's just like, no, Toby told me I'm not allowed to work with Ryu anymore. And I'm like, yeah, because Ryu's a dick. It's just that simple. All right, guys, so definitely check it out tomorrow. There's also another game coming up later on tonight for WePlay. That is, I believe it is Ewolves. It is Infamous going up against Elite Wolves. That game begins in what is now 2 hours and 15 minutes. We're going to shut down the stream for that one. I believe Llama is jumping into the hot seat to cast that game. The more action coming up tomorrow. We actually have more. Actually, we've got two games coming up for America tonight by the looks of it. Yay! More Dota 2 coming your way as far as we play, guys. So keep your eyes peeled for all of that. The game is tomorrow. And as far as I go, that was actually my last cast before I travel to Shanghai on Sunday. So I'll see you guys at the major coverage. Hope you have a great time watching those games. I'm going to be pimping the living crap out of my Twitter and Facebook when the China Great Wall lets me have access to it. So keep your eyes peeled for all of that kind of jazz. And we'll see you next time on the live stream.
Safe travels, Toby. Bye.